Thank you for that scintillating introduction, Michelle. Okay, everyone should be able to hear me now. I can certainly hear an echo, so that's great. So Andrew and myself are from the Center for High Performance Computing. Basically, here's the obligatory title slide where we, shall we say, give credit, yes, that's the polite way of putting it, to the CSR, who are our taskmasters, and the Department of Science and Technology, who are our paymasters. Yeah, it's not easy having two masters, but anyway. So we're at the Center for High Performance Computing, which is just a couple of blocks down the road in Rosebank. And it is essentially South Africa's supercomputer center. So we have several big machines. That's the core machine, which is the Sun cluster. It's been expanded since then. I'm just starting with this one because I've got some nice photographs of it. And just to give you an idea of what kind of work we do, the programming sort of paradigm we have to look at, which is highly parallel because we have to deal with programs that can scale to over 2,000 cores and more. Huge amounts of RAM. Everything's connected with very fast quad data rate InfiniBand. So that's running at 40 gigabits per second. So that machine alone is 24 teraflops. As I said, we've expanded it since then, so we're beyond 60 teraflops now. And that's excluding all the co-processors like the Intel Phis and the NVIDIA Kepler cards that we have in the expansion. But the key takeaway for you is the URL in the bottom right-hand corner. So there you can go and find more information about the CHPC and about high-performance computing. I'll just quickly introduce high-performance computing to motivate why we got involved with using Python as frontends for fluid dynamics. So high-performance computing is using parallel processing, right? Run advanced applications like fluid dynamics efficiently, reliably, and quickly. Okay, so you think we'd start with the quickly bit, you know, high-performance computing, but it turns out the efficiently is very important because you don't want to use too much electricity or resources, etc. And the reliably is very, very important. It's no good getting a wrong answer faster than anyone else. It's still a wrong answer. And for the purposes of today, high-performance computing is any system above a teraflop, though we might have to adjust that to 10 teraflops, given that you could buy something like a Intel Xeon Phi and the card alone is supposed to achieve 1 teraflop. Well, good luck programming it, but it's also very interesting to program it because it's so challenging. And I mentioned they're up to 16 and more petaflops because that's where the top supercomputers are at the moment, is a few tens of teraflops. The key thing about high performance computing is that it's big science. Right. I should show you the previous picture since that reflects back to Simon's talk yesterday. This is a electromagnetic simulation of one of the antennas that is used by CAT. What you actually see there is the current induced in that by lightning strike a couple of kilometers away. So that happens to be a big problem for Meerkat since the Karoo is well known in summer to have a lot of lightning strikes. And the intensity of the current there is sufficient to A, damage equipment, and B, swamp out any very faint signal you're trying to get from several parsecs away. All the way up to cosmology, model the whole universe, why not? To fluid dynamics, which is kind of more exciting, you know, things like rockets, drones, I don't know, UVAs as well, but more challenging. So what I'm going to do now is pass over to my colleague, Andrew. So now we're doing a context thread switch, who will introduce you to fluid dynamics.
Yeah. So. Right. Yes, can you hear me?
Yeah.
Okay. So after Kevin gave you that background on the CHPC, I'll give you a little background on myself. I'm a mechanical engineer. So I view computers and Python and all these things basically as tools which can get the job done more easily for me. I don't worry too much about trying to get things done elegantly. Anyway, my background is, as he said, fluid mechanics, particularly to a large extent, computational fluid mechanics or CFD. If I may just ask, how many people here have some background in fluid mechanics, have taken a university course or something? Okay, quite a few. So for those who haven't, I'll give a very brief potted view of, or a potted description of CFD, a little introduction. Basically, what we're looking at there, the purpose of it, of course, is that you want to try and numerically solve the Navier-Stokes equation. The Navier-Stokes equation, as you probably all know already, is basically just Newton 2 for fluids, for fluid flows. It's basically the momentum equation, but rephrased. I've given a simplified, slightly simplified version there for incompressible flow cases. If you can solve that equation analytically, there's $1 million waiting for you somewhere in America. So we solve it numerically. Why we use it is because it's quite expensive doing wind tunnel testing or any kind of experimental testing. You can save a lot of time and money if you can actually just numerically simulate the thing, of course. So basically the way we go about deriving an approximate numerical solution is this. If you look at the block at the top there, that block represents a block of fluid. It might be, say, a piece of ventilation duct or something. And then we break the block up into a whole lot of smaller blocks, as is shown below. That's the process of discretizing it into a mesh or a grid. You then go and you look at each block and you look at its neighbors, and you approximate the derivatives of the velocity and the pressure for each one using a mathematical technique known as the finite volume method, which I won't go into now. And then basically once you've done this, you solve a great big system of linear equations which give you the velocity and pressure. You then go and check back with the original continuity equations, make sure that everything works, and when you find out that there's an error, which we call a residual, you correct according to the size and the direction of that residual, and then you repeat the entire process again until the residual drops to some arbitrarily small value which you consider to be accurate enough. So that's what it does, but there are a couple of things that you've got to watch. First of all, obviously your solution has to approximate reality. Now this is not quite as easy to achieve as it might sound. For one thing, the shape of your grid, your computational grid, obviously if you have a very, very coarse mesh, it's quite obvious that you're not necessarily going to approximate reality. You can't, say, model flow around an airline with four cells. But not only the size, but also the shape and the degree of refinement and the areas in which you refine the grid. Refinement is basically just how big the cells are near the object that you are trying to simulate the flow around. All of these things can have an effect on your result and can introduce artificial artifacts, if you like, inaccuracies in your solution, which will not be there if you were to go and analyze flow around a wind tunnel model. Also, if you are using an inappropriate numerical model, you will obviously get rubbish out. But sometimes some numerical models are slightly more appropriate than others. You have to know which ones to use. Now, on top of all of this, you very seldom run one simulation. You normally run a whole batch of these simulations, as we implied in the last slide. So basically, you end up repeating the simulations quite a bit, either because you've made an error in the setup, knowingly or unknowingly, because you're trying to do a sensitivity study, or just because you have, that's the nature of the problem. You're trying to analyze a number of different data points. And so because this is a rather repetitive process, obviously you want to find some way to automate it somehow. Whoops. Just go back. How do I go back?
Try page up.
Page up will work. No, I've gone too far. Sorry about this. This always happens to me. Okay, whipping through that.
There we go.
So now I've briefly tried to give an outline of the way in which you'll go about running a CFD simulation. Now you're just looking at one. You're not looking at the entire study, which will be done in some sort of variation of either a design problem or the scientific method, their techniques for designing experiments and so on. But if you're actually doing a particular CFD study on a particular problem, you will first have to pre-process it. That means you have to import the geometry onto your CFD package. Now, if you are in academia, you're generally quite lucky because you can sometimes do this quite simply, because you're generally dealing with simple geometries in research, generally, not always. However, in industry, and sometimes in academia as well, you sometimes get somebody else's 3D model, which a draftsperson cooked up in computer-aided design package somewhere. This can cause all kinds of problems. My friend Kevin here has actually damaged his one wrist by overuse of a mouse in trying to correct the problems in other people's models. So this takes quite a bit of time. Once you've actually finally got a workable geometry into your computer, you then have to actually generate a mesh around it. Now remember, we are actually looking at the gas or liquid around the object that you are interested in here. So you then got to go and discretize that volume. You've got to also choose an appropriate volume, which is another story. once you've done that, you've got to define the physical properties, the density of the air or the liquid or whatever, the viscosity, whatever other properties, if there are heat transfer going on, ambient temperature, the such things. You've then got to go and you've got to tweak the model. You've got to say what sort of finite difference scheme you want to use to approximate your derivatives. You've got to set time steps if it's a transient problem. You've got to set relaxation factors in the model so that the thing doesn't blow up on you. The residuals will start climbing and eventually the solution diverges. And you finally got to actually decide what numerical values you want to extract from the model. Once you've done that, you set the model running, you watch your residuals, which I mentioned earlier, and you just hope that the residuals go down, 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 down to below 10 to the minus 6 or 10 to the minus 9, whatever accuracy level you choose. They're normally normalized relative to the initial values or something. Then once you've got that, you've got to post-process your data that is converted into human usable form. Initially, you of course do a sanity check and make sure that your results are in some way physically meaningful. After this, you begin to visualize your results, that is, you create pretty pictures. The other name for the other meaning of CFD is colors for directors, because it generally produces colorful pictures. And then you actually extract the data which you need for your experiment, for your analysis, whatever. Now, as I mentioned, there's a lot of repetition involved in this. So I've made a flowchart to actually show how much repetition can actually be involved. This is the entire process I've just described as a flowchart. As you can see there, there are lots of times where you've got to go and check things and go back and redo things and go back and redo things again and make sure your geometry is correct and then check your mesh and then fiddle the mesh to get it acceptable. Because if those little cells are too long and thin, the aspect ratio is too high, or if they are generally too skew and they don't resemble cubes anymore, or tetrahedra if you're using those, if they're not regular enough, you start running into problems and your solution diverges and you have to start from scratch again. So it's a very repetitive process. Now, there are a number of CFD packages out there. I'm going to speak about one in particular called OpenFoam. It's probably the most popular open source CFD package. There are more popular commercial ones, but in terms of open source, it's also a very versatile package. It's generally a very good package, but it has certain limitations. For those of you who know CFD, it's a finite volume segregated solver, and it can also be used to, you can use it to develop your own solvers. It has some pretty good libraries in it. It's written in C++, so it uses object-oriented programming. It uses some fairly advanced and slightly, to me at least, slightly cryptic features of C++, like templating, operator overloading, all kinds of funny things like that. The code is not particularly nice to have to look at, even if you know C++. It's pretty badly documented as well. In the manual, it actually tells you to consult the source code for most of the functionality of the code. You don't really want to see this. On top of which, the boundary conditions which you specify, those, for those of you who don't know CFD, those are the conditions on the edges of those blocks. You've got to specify the inlet velocities, the pressures at the edges of your domain that you're examining, and so on. If you want to do anything more simple, anything more complicated than very simple constants, you've basically got to go and write some C++ code yourself. And not just normal C++ code, you've got to do it within the OpenFoam framework, which is pretty non-standard C++, which, as I've already mentioned, is not well documented. So there's a bit of a problem there. Then there's the model input. There are loads and loads of text files which you use for configuration. I'll show you a picture of the input file structure for a single case just now. Also, there's no flow control within the input files. They look a little bit like C++. These are now the text files for configuration and so on. But it's not C++. It's not any other scripting language. And it looks like you should be able to specify things as mathematical functions in a normal sort of programming type of way, but you can't. You can only use constant values, basically. There are a few setup tools which make the whole process easier because there are all these loads of text files using a slightly cryptic format, but they generally also need configuration files, so it doesn't really help as much as you would like. And the other thing, which isn't a problem probably for most people here, but a lot of mechanical engineers are allergic to the command line, and all the tools in OpenFoam, except some of the post-processing, are command line based. So anyway, that's actually what the file structure looks like once you actually run an OpenFoam case for, say, one iteration. You can see there are a number of subdirectories within the case directory. There's a system subdirectory, and that mostly, but not entirely, contains the model configuration and a few things about output and some other things that developers thought should go there. And then there's the constants, which are all of the constants related to flow and the flow problem itself. It also contains the polymesh directory, which contains the blockmesh dict file, which is the input for generating the mesh, and the tri-service.stl file, which is a 3D file in STL format, which you use to read in a 3D geometry if you have to do that. and then you've got to go and specify the individually specify the initial conditions for each one of the variables you're solving for, the velocity, the pressure, the turbulence properties, and so on. And then it generates an additional directory for each time step or iteration that it's basically solving for. So anyway, this is pretty clumsy to actually work with. You can do it, but obviously it benefits a bit from some automation, as I've said already. And so, I'm not getting to that yet. This is just an example of the block mesh file. This is the file in which you specify the initial input, with the initial geometry, you input the initial geometry. I've shown you what the picture on the side is, not in the file, it's just a text file, but that shows you what it's trying to do. This is a relatively simple example, but when your geometry gets a bit more complicated, what you're looking at there, of course, is you first specify the nodes at the corners of the block. You specify how many blocks, cells you want to divide the block up into. You have to specify the edges explicitly. You have to specify the faces of the block explicitly, and so on. And this is a really small example. There are only four little cells there, and there are only eight points defining the whole thing. But
and I should just point out the syntax is definitely not Python-like.
No.
All those curly brackets, despite the fact that these files are called dictionaries,
are
not defining a Python dictionary at all.
So this was a slightly more complicated geometry that I had to prepare at some point. I did manually write the block mesh dict file, and I think you can see why each one of those little magenta things is a number of one of those coordinates, and those have to be ordered in a specific way in order for the geometry not to be inside out, so to speak. You don't want to go and manually write the block mesh dict file for one of these things.
And you thought we weren't going to get around to Python.
Now we get around to Python at last. Now, a lot of people had this problem, and somebody by the name of Bernard Schneider and some of his colleagues got together and wrote a library called PyFoam, which is basically just a Python wrapper for most of the functionality of OpenFoam. And it's got wrappers for the solvers, it's got wrappers for the utilities, the meshing utilities, the post-processing utilities, all of these things. It allows you to control these things. It also, which is rather nice, man, it allows you to control most of those dictionary files, which Kevin just mentioned. You can read them in and non-destructively change their properties. And OpenFoam is written in such a way, one of its nice features, that while it is running, you can actually modify those properties, and those will be reflected in your simulation. It gives you tools to set up the cases, it gives you tools to run the cases, to monitor the residuals, and to post-process the residuals, where you have to post-process the cases. And you can also, which is quite nice, watch the residuals and graphics in real time without resorting to sed. You can pipe them to sed with GNU plot and things like that. I don't know how to use sed. I don't want to know how to use sed. This saves me from having to learn it. And then there are also some tools for benchmarking OpenFoam solvers, which Kevin will say a bit more about later. Then this fellow, now PyFoam is just mainly for a set of utilities which, as I said, allow you to run OpenFoam more easily. But he also went a bit further, and he made it possible to specify more complicated boundary conditions and more complicated initial conditions and more complicated mathematical functions in your boundary condition files. And it's going to OpenFoam can then understand them and read them, and you don't have to go and handcraft your own boundary conditions in C++.
I'll just point out that it's Groovy BC and Funky Setfield that allow you to actually put in Python-like expressions in your dictionaries, which SWUC for Foam then interprets and will then replace with the actual numerical values that OpenFoam itself needs. It simplifies the writing of those OpenFoam dictionaries considerably because you can now put in these values, and it also allows you to dynamically do calculations while OpenFoam is running.
Okay, so now we're going to move on to a test case. It was just an application, if you like. It was a little thing which I cooked up. It started out pretty much as a hobby project, but starting to think it might have some other uses. What I basically wanted to do was I wanted to generate a mesh around an elliptical wing. For those of you who know something about aerodynamics, an elliptical wing is the minimum induced drag. That's why a lot of World War II fighters, like the Spitfire and so on, high-performance aircraft, at that stage had elliptical wings. I think it's slightly different in the compressible flow, but not very much. So in general, it's just a good design choice to make an elliptical wing. And I wanted to do this as a hobby project because I rather like aircraft. And I wanted to try and do this using OpenFoam because I don't have to have a license for it. Now, if you want to generate a mesh in OpenFoam, there are two meshing utilities that you want to use. You're going to use block mesh dict, which I just showed you the dictionary for earlier. That basically produces block structured meshes. It takes a block and it divides it up regularly into little blocks, as you've already seen. the blocks have to be hexahedral. And now it can consistently create relatively high quality meshes if you say, if you do it sensibly, but it's a rather time consuming, as we've already mentioned. It's rather a hassle to do it by hand. The other option is to use snappy hex mesh. What you do then is you start up with a very simple mesh generated, block mesh generated with block mesh dict, and from that you basically cut out your 3D geometry, and then you make the cells around the 3D geometry finer, that you've cut out finer, the ones that are touching the surface of it, if you like. You make them finer by cutting them up, and you snap the cells to the edges, so you distort those cells in such a way that they follow the geometry more closely. Now, this is actually, when it works reasonably well, and it's a lot less effort than a lot of other meshing techniques, but it doesn't always work. It's not consistent. And the other problem, if you're doing something on the cheap, is that you need a CAD package to do it, and there's only one CAD package, proper 3D parametric CAD package that I know of that is available open source, and it's still under pretty heavy development. So that's another limitation.
You can think of this process this way. It's like building a sculpture using only Lego bricks, right? So you're not going to get very smooth curved surfaces, but if you can use the tiniest little one by one bricks, you can get pretty close so that when you look at it from a distance, it looks smoothish.
Yes. Right. And then basically what Atom Foam eventually does is it actually melts the corners of the brick slightly so it's smoother. Okay, so now moving on, after that background, moving on to the actual problem itself. As we've said, it's a problem to get 3D geometries into this thing. Now, there are some, and there are these two different meshing strategies. You can actually use the two of them together, but that's not important for now. What I want to say is that some geometries, like aircraft wings, are quite difficult to model correctly or to mesh correctly using snappy hex mesh, which is the easier way of doing it. But they do lend themselves quite well to block meshing structures. There are standard ways of arranging your blocks so that you can actually get a good quality mesh around the wing. Now, as I've said, it's a tedious process to write a block mesh dict file, but because this thing is structured and the points, the nodes, the vertices, whatever you want to call them, are ordered for your blocks, you can quite easily knock together a Python script to generate these things. It's a bit laborious. It's very boring. I'll show you the code just now, but it's entirely doable. And then afterwards, for fun, you can put some PyFoam functions in and you can run the entire thing by just calling one Python script. So that's actually the bit of code that calls the functions and then calls block mesh, called block mesh dict, generates the file and so on. I will show you the function that actually generates block mesh dict itself. There we go. And it goes down and it goes down and it goes down and lots and lots and lots of write statements with a little bit of maths in between. There's nothing particularly exciting, but there it is. Okay, so what you're looking at there is you first generate the root aerofoil, the little function that I wrote. That was actually originally written for another commercial CFD package so I can generate input files, but it was many years ago, but it's still useful. And then you set a couple of variables, and then you call the write mesh function, which I just showed you. And that basically just does all the grinding along the way and does the entire laborious process. Then you call one of PyFoam's runners or runner applications, and it runs the block mesh utility on the block mesh dict. Then if you want to, you can view it in ParaView, which is a visualization program. It allows you to see your mesh. And if it looks okay, you carry on. And then you actually run the simulation itself. The simulation here is simple foam. Simple foam is just a particular solver within open foam. It runs steady-state incompressible flow simulations, which are sort of bread and butter for this kind of problem. After this, you can start doing the post-processing. It allows you to monitor the plot runner, allows you to plot and monitor the residuals, the errors from the simulation as that simulation progresses. And then you calculate the Y plus values. That's just a turbulence property to check whether your turbulence modeling was correct. And after that, you can go and process it further in ParaFoam. So now to the pictures. This is the first stage. This is the output of the block mesh. If you look at the top left corner, you can see the mesh as it looks. If you cut away the outer boundaries, you can see the wing itself in the big picture. My apologies for the resolution. It's not very high there, is it? And then I just zoomed in a bit closer so you can see the mesh close to the wing, where it's actually most important.
Remember you're modeling the fluid. So what matters here is that the blocks are where the fluid is flowing. So the wing itself is actually empty. because no fluid goes into the wing. So just remember that. So what, that's what we're actually importantly meshing. So it's like you did that Lego model
around
as an inverse. In other words, you did the model around the wing, and the wing itself is just the vacuum.
You take out the blocks that correspond to the wing from the big rectangle block. So after that, I decided with very little tweaking, I could make better looking meshes where the cells were more orthogonal and less skew, less had smaller aspect ratios and changes in expansion ratios. The size adjacent cells should be roughly the same size and shape. And I got what they call a classical C mesh around the aerofoil. I did a couple of other fun things. I decided to make a swept inverted gull wing. You can specify the dihedral of your wing. You can specify the angle of sweep. You can change the angle of attack. You can do all these things by changing one or two parameters in the Python script because you're just calling a couple of functions.
The fact that it's darker in the center around the wing is simply because the volumes we're using there are much smaller. So that's because you want greater accuracy here, because this is where the interesting fluid flow is happening. Here, where you know it's just going to be more or less straightforward laminar flow, nothing much is happening here, but around the wing and behind the wing, of course, you need greater accuracy, which means you need a finer resolution in your volume cells.
Okay, then the simulation itself runs. Does this thing still work?
Yes.
The simulation itself is still running. You can see the brightly colored worms crawling down towards 10 to the minus 4. This is actually quite a coarse mesh, so the residuals, by the time it converges, the residuals are still pretty high. But because this is not actually going to be used in anger at the moment, it's not too important. It gives reasonable results as you can expect for such a mesh. So it's close to converged there. And then, after it's all converged, you can make pretty pictures. Now, what you're looking at here, are you looking at some streamlines flowing over the wing. And you can see that the coloration of those streamlines is determined by the velocity along the wing in the x direction, if you look at the little red arrow in the corner. So if it's red, it's high velocity, and if it's blue, it's low velocity. And what you might find interesting is if you look at the bottom right corner, there is a vortex there, a swirling structure. That's characteristic of a wing. All aircraft wings will have that, and if you've noticed on airliners, there are little winglets on them. That's generally to disrupt that structure, because that structure wastes energy and decreases the lift of the wing. And then a slightly more engineeringly meaningful, post-processing from engineering point of view, look at the pressure field around the wing. You can see the pressure is under the wing is red. It's higher than the green on top of the wing. And then I plotted out the pressure as a function of chord. That's the along the direction of the wing as well. So you can see that's a fairly normal pressure profile for this type of wing.
Also notice that the wing is slightly angled, right? So that's to make sure that your plane is actually flying as opposed to going down.
Yes, that's the angle of attack. Yeah. If you vary that, in fact, you can actually, for this particular wing airfoil, you can actually have a slightly negative angle of attack and still generate lift, but it doesn't work as well. But yeah, that's another story. And I think now I hand over to my colleague Kevin. No, first I'll tell you about the future improvements. Obviously, I can add a GUI in front of it. There's a lot of extra functionality I can add in. I can allow you to tweak all of the modeling parameters, which are done in a very sloppy, lazy way at the moment. So it'll be a lot more use of PyFoam. I want to very much extend this to work with axial flow fans or turbines, because basically, if you take a fan blade or turbine blade, it's basically just a wing on a curved hub and with a curved case around it. These exact same meshing strategies that I've explained will work very well. I'm then going to have to use Groovy BC from Swap for Foam, which I haven't yet had a chance to use, because OpenFoam in its normal state doesn't like modeling swirling in that boundary conditions and so on. And you can also, of course, it'd be fun to go and implement numerical optimization. Because it's all in Python, I can pull in NumPy and SciPy and all associated libraries. And you can run an iterative solution where you set up and run a CFD solution, tweak it to get according to the optimization scheme, and then run it again, and so on. And yeah, so that's, yeah. Now I hand over to Kevin. How do I take this thing off? There.
Okay, hopefully that still works. Right. Whoops. Right, so I'm just going to talk briefly about benchmarking because that's of interest from my point of view, because I want to be able to benchmark the systems at the HPC and other designs that we experiment with, depending on whether you have a lot of very small nodes, which means you can parallelize a lot, or it's necessary to have fewer nodes, but each node is fat with, say, a lot of fast cores and a big chunk of memory. So we want to be able to automate the process of running different OpenFOAM simulations so that we can actually track the performance of the hardware we have. So I started with PyFOAM Bench. Unfortunately, that hasn't been updated for a while, and it only works automatically with much older versions of OpenFOAM. So what I did was I looked at the code and then adapted some parts of it. And because it's all using PyFOAM, okay, it's pretty straightforward, and PyFOAM itself is up to date, up to the most recent release of OpenFOAM. So I was able to write a major Python control script, which was able to do several of the standard tutorials that come with OpenFOAM, run them in different configurations with different parameters for both the mesh, that is the number of volumes, finite volume cells you have, and also how those cells are distributed across, how you do the domain decomposition across the parallel hardware. The example I'm just going to show here as a demonstration is a three-dimensional wave break example. Actually, I've modified the boundary condition slightly, as you'll see when I show you the picture. The mesh sizes that we're looking at, because we want to really stress high-performance computing, is 100,000 million, 10 million cells, and, as I said, different parallel decompositions. So we call this the Cape Wave benchmark because, you know, sort of semi-humorously, we decided, what happens if a tsunami hits the stadium that no one seems to like? So that is the donut approximation to the stadium and its walls and the buildings nearby. And that's actually the performance. But what I'm going to do is I'm going to switch over to a video to show you what actually it looks like. So in a normal wave break example, you just have a dam wall with a whole lot of water behind it. And then you instantaneously, because this is a simulation, remove the wall and let the water just flow in. We modified this to simulate a tsunami by saying there's actually an infinite amount of water in the ocean. And we said it was going to be 12 meters high and moving fairly slowly. I think it's only about 12 or so meters per second. So it's not too fast, I think. No, 2 meters per second, sorry. I'm way off in my figures. Okay, so this is, shall we say, what happened to the poor Japanese, except it's local. Very unrealistic because the buildings don't break. They're completely rigid structures. That's why you see this wave, because of the sheer amount of water behind it, just splashing over the buildings. But the fact that the wave, the water itself, gets to that high is simply because of the sheer momentum and energy behind a typical tsunami. In reality, of course, those buildings would be demolished, would be wiped out by the sheer volume of water and energy. Now, it's a little bit thin, but I hope you can see that this is the performance on that node. So that, as you can see, is just two cores. That's just running on one core, of course. That's where I normalized it to. Then I used all 8 cores on the node, and you can see it doesn't quite scale, but remember, that's for 150,000 cells. Because the key thing about making sure that your parallel code runs successfully is it must be a big enough problem that there's a lot of parallelism, a lot of work you can actually give to the individual cores. So I then went to a 900,000 and started here at 8 and started doubling it to 16, 32 and already noticed it started falling off, that is, wasn't speeding up linearly. So then I went to this 3.6 million. You'll notice the factors I'm using, and that's because I'm actually changing the domain decomposition. Remember, it's an XYZ decomposition. So sometimes I double the number of cells in the X direction and the Y direction, but keep it constant. Or sometimes I could do a 2 times 3 or 2 by 2 by 2, right? And then I went even further and said, okay, with the 3.6 million, right, let me start out with 64, and then double it and see how far I can get before they said to me, okay, you've now using the whole machine, other people want to use it, so stop. But as you can see, because the 3.6 million is actually a very large problem, it actually got slightly faster because there was just enough parallel work in that job that really you had to use the 512 core. Okay, so in conclusion, right, the repetitive nature of the CFD analysis really lends it well to automation. And we all know that Python is a very user-friendly language to use, and so we prefer to use Python scripting. In fact, we use Python in a lot of other areas at the CHPC as well. Now, Python, PyFirm, SWAC4Firm provide a lot of features that A, help inexperienced users of Fluid Dynamics and OpenFirm, because it means that you can actually do some things that if you had to do them directly in OpenFirm, you would have to delve into C++ programming, or you'd have to do a lot of tedious other types of scripting to alter all those text files. You save a lot of time for advanced users, especially for batch jobs, automating jobs, running jobs with slightly different parameters, doing benchmarking and the like. It's a workaround for the limitations of OpenFirm's own tools, and as I just showed you, it's great to automate benchmarking. So thank you very much. Right, are there any questions for either of us? Yeah. Okay.
Right.
Yeah.
I'm not an engineer, but I come more from a computational biology background. Okay. Where we simulations, but also with finite volume, mm-hmm. I've been using FiPy as mm-hmm. a software. I just wanted to know whether you're actually aware of that.
Yes, I've used different modules for Python for doing various things. We tend to find that because OpenFirm is so mature as a code, we're able to do a lot more with that. I myself have done a lot of finite element analysis in Python, particularly because the PySparse module provides very efficient sparse matrix arithmetic operations. And in fact, I found that that alone outperforms MATLAB. So I don't know why people are still using MATLAB for similar things.
But similarly, if implementing this on the CHPC, is there a possibility to install?
Oh, yes, absolutely. Sorry, I should have concluded with a slide saying, go to the CHPC website and see if you need to use our machines. We have different versions of Python. We have NumPy. We have MPI for Py, which is crucial for doing the parallelism. That is actually distributing the work across the cluster. Because the key thing about our cluster, our biggest machines, are that they are distributed memory. Your program has to be able to pass messages, which is just data packets, essentially, between running instances of your program in order to share the results. You can see with the finite volume approach, you have a volume, and then you have to share the fluid flow as well as the shear on the surfaces with neighboring cells. And so you would similarly do that with many other tasks. Back there? No, you cannot. In fact, our own experiments with, maybe I shouldn't mention the actual commercial, two big companies who have big cloud infrastructure were very unsuccessful. The reason being is that with Python's approach, it's a domain decomposition. Every iteration that is computing what's happening inside a volume, right, it has to be able to share that information with neighboring cells. So inter-process communication has to be fast, which is why we have the quad speed InfiniBand, and really we'd like that to be faster.
Okay,
yeah.
Is it a
bandwidth constraint? Yeah, definitely a bandwidth constraint, yeah. And I should mention the other thing, even as a serial process, it's a memory bandwidth constraint problem because you end up with a sparse system to solve, which means that there's very little computation per element of the matrix that you're loading in. So you want to get those elements in very fast as possible.
Does OpenFOAM and PyFOAM have a central code repository that you can contribute to?
Yes. We probably flashed by without mentioning it, but there's openfoam.org, which is the central place for OpenFOAM. They have a subversion repository, I believe, right? They do take contributions. However, they very strictly vet their contributions. Yeah. They're a lot like Linus Torvalds in that respect. On the other hand, the PyFOAM, etc., that's off the OpenFOAM wiki. There you can contribute any of your own code, right? You just have to name it differently from what already exists, and it gets added in, and then people can come along. So those are the utilities and tools around OpenFOAM. That's a lot more free process than OpenFOAM, the code itself. Question over there?
You mentioned using PyFOAM and SWAC4FOAM for modeling a rotating turbine blade. Can you also do things like taking the results of a previous iteration? Say, for example, you get a high pressure area on something. Can you then model, you feed that back into providing deformation in of the shape?
Hold on.
It should be possible. There's actually a finite volume structural solver as opposed to the normal finite element. So some people are working on that. There are other people who are working on coupling it to other finite element solvers, not OpenFOAM. I haven't done any of that myself, but I know some people who are working on that. I think Richard, the back, wanted to. Well, now that I've written the script, it's probably it's easy. Before, it was definitely a bit more human effort. There was definitely a big gap between setting up an OpenFOAM job and setting up a Fluent job or a NUMECA job or whatever.
Would probably parallelize better because what you're seeing, the results I'm showing it is actually after I did much tweaking and key. Because you have a mixture of two fluids, it starts out initially where you'll have many volumes that only have one fluid. But as it goes along, it gets more and more complicated, so you'll find that it's important to balance the load, the computational effort, and distribute that, which means you're actually doing a dynamic parallel decomposition while you're running that in order to get good speed up.
That was kind of the gist of my question, because typically, you know, there's going to be a whole bunch of areas there where a pretty complicated flow phenomenon is happening. It seems that I guess it would be possible that relative to a more typical steady state kind of problem, your problem would end up doing more compute for the amount of data and shunting.
Yes, absolutely. Yeah. Now, the fact is that problem actually has a very good parallelization simply because it has an enormous workload. The biggest problem we have with steady state or quasi-static analysis is that you'll find too many of your nodes will be idle. They won't be doing that much work. You had a comment?
One of my other colleagues actually did a study on a more normal single phase case, and he got very slightly superlinear. I can't remember how many million cells he went up to, but he also got a linear or better speed up over, I think he went to even larger number of cells actually, but he was using the single phase, was using pimple foam, I think. It's an unsteady.
I should just add that when you play to OpenFirm's strengths, it actually outperforms many of the commercial codes. And that's what we were actually doing with these examples.
Okay, I think we should stop now because it's 3 o'clock, but I do want to add to that. I thought your speed ups were fantastic looking at chemistry codes, which would never have speed ups even close to linear like that usually. So, yes, questions afterwards.